Hi, everybody, and welcome to our Motivation Assist podcast. And today I'm delighted to be joined by Robbie O'Neill, who is a very valued member of our team and has been with us 12 years now, Robbie, is it? Yeah, okay. And I know you're certainly somebody who's juggled many balls within the company and taken on many roles. So maybe you would like to tell us a little bit about your background and the history during your time with us.
I started out in motivation 12 years ago now, and I started out on the reception desk. It was one of those things I never saw myself doing. Mm-hmm. But as the months went on, I spent about 4 months at the reception desk, and I saw the value of motivation as a company and what we did, and decided that I would like to become a consultant. And from there, I spent 10 years consulting with clients.
Is it that long?
Absolutely.
My goodness.
Yeah.
Time flies.
And leading me to study psychotherapy as a direct result of it, you know, so that I could have a better understanding of what was going on with people, and a better empathy, I suppose, would be the thing that I was looking for more. And using it in the consultations, you know, the CBT consultations that we do, and the theory behind what we do. From there, I've gone on to manage clinics, and I'm part of the training team now. So I train the different consultants in what they need to be doing, or the way that they need to be reacting to clients.
Super. So you really, as you say, understand, you really get it. You've been consulting a long time, like myself, nearly gone in the door the other way around, did all your training and CBT and psychology afterwards.
Yeah.
So thank you for joining us. We're delighted to have you. So it's particularly great, Robbie, that you're with us because this podcast is about men's health, and it is a blog that we covered recently that we've had huge feedback from our male clients, and we've had a lot of men calling to book in and make an assessment and do the program. The statistics were very interesting, a little depressing, but realistic, about life expectancy for the Irish male, in that it's 5 years less than the average female. So that is a little bit depressing. But we want to look beyond just statistics into what the potential is for men to start taking their own health into their hands without huge transformations, and to make small, simple changes to their diet and their fitness. So our clients, many of our clients, Robbie, you will know this, will mention benefits that seem small but huge in the context of their lives, such as being able to walk up several flights of stairs, not being out of breath, being able to kick a football around with their son or daughter. So I know we set goals for male clients. They're very goal focused.
Yeah.
What is your experience you can share with the male clients and females who have male partners or friends? What has your experience been with male clients over the years?
With male clients, it tends to be that they come in when they have significant amount of weight to lose, rather than when, with female clients, we tend to see them earlier in the weight loss process. But with male clients, they tend to come in kind of later, and therefore they have more weight to lose. And so then they become very goal orientated as far as the scale is concerned. So they're looking at the scale every week to tell them how well they're doing. And that's great when they start out. And because of what we do here at Motivation, we tend to not focus on the scales as much. So one of the questions that we ask is, what benefits do they feel they got this week? Or what benefits do they feel they've got from just losing the weight that they've lost so far? And it's amazing the things that they come up with. You know, I had one client turn out to me one day and said, I'm able to swing a club better. I never thought I was going to be able to hit the ball as far as I do.
The golfer. Yeah.
And, you know, you're looking and you're saying, you know, these are the small things that they want to get. These are the, you know, rather than the big things of that number on the scales, the small things. I'm able to walk on a Sunday with my family. You know, I used to sit in the car and wait for them to come back because I didn't want them to see how much I was struggling.
Mm-hmm.
And so by just losing, and that could be a stone, that could be a stone and a half, but even that, those small changes that they've made have significant, and that feel good factor that they have.
Yeah.
It gives them just those little things.
Yeah, small things, but they have a big effect. And then you mentioned golf there. What with regard to exercise, you know, people would often ask me, I'm sure you've heard this as well, what is the best exercise to do to lose weight, etc.? And we would always say something you enjoy. I was asked recently, it was interesting, what my opinion was on Instagram and social media and bloggers, these fitness bloggers. And I know, I'm sure you see it too, a lot of clients, male and female, but particularly males, they come into the clinic and tell us that they will follow a very high intensity form of exercise. They're working out, they're going to the gym, they're doing bodybuilding, etc. And certainly, I don't know how you feel, I'm sure you feel the same, that as a male, in your perspective, Robbie, do you think men feel under pressure to look a certain way, to be this body with muscle, and what's your opinion on that?
From the client's point of view, even from my own point of view, there is a lot of, you look at the TV, you look at the footballers and the people that you hold in high esteem, and you want to be like them. Mm-hmm. And that's only in your mind. You, a lot of times it's not vocalized, but you work towards that. And so when you're doing exercise, or when you're doing anything that's going to bodybuild, or anything that's going to, you want to look a certain way. Mm-hmm. And so you put your all into it, mm-hmm. you know, and you mm-hmm. try, and it's nearly all until you can't do any more.
Okay. So extremes. Okay. Yeah. So are we talking a bit of perfectionism there as it comes up on our mental weight reports?
Yeah. And it's very interesting when you're reading back with a male client, as we're talking about males, how many times perfectionism comes up. And they're like, me, I'm sure I'm not a perfectionist, you know, and then when you explain to them, it's the all or nothing.
Yeah, absolutely. You know,
I'm either doing this or I'm not. Mm. I'm either going to be that way or I'm not going to be that way. So, you know, when you explain to them, it's like, oh, okay, now I get it. Mm-hmm. You know, this is something that's actually having an impact on the weight loss, on their life in general, you know, and by just changing a little bit and saying, okay, I'm going to be maybe the best that I can be. And changes for them.
Yeah. And what's interesting too is back to, you know, with socializing with men, you had said there, which was very interesting, about, you know, gentlemen, or a case history of somebody sitting in the car, the male partner, husband, and not talking to, not discussing, you know, how they felt or discussing their weight. And that brings me back to something that was in our blog also, which was really interesting and I found surprising. It said men can be more social than women on a regular basis, with 52% reporting to take part in a regular social activity with friends, compared to just 43% of women. Now, I found that really, really interesting, because I would have thought women were a lot more sociable with their coffee mornings, etc. I think now that I'm saying it, I'm thinking of mammals, all the men I see cycling. What's it stand for? Middle-aged men in Lycra or something, yeah. Which is another middle age and midlife crisis is another topic I think we have in store for our listeners. But it's really interesting, because it is important. It shows social bonds are crucial for our health, and talking is really important for our health. So has it been your experience overall, Robbie, that male clients are inclined not to talk, that they're holding in emotions and how they feel?
Yeah, definitely. You know, when they come in, again, going back to, you know, in a client situation, they are very focused on what they need to do. And again, it's when you get to the mental aids stage and you're saying to them, you know, would that apply to you? Or, you know, is that habit, the assertiveness side of it, the passivity side of it, you know, where they sit back and allow it to happen, and maybe don't talk to people about it as much. What you're saying about the social situations, it seems more acceptable to men to allow themselves to go a little bit further, and therefore in social situations they don't tend to look around and say, oh, I'd like to be like him out loud. Mm-hmm. Whereas for women, there is that feeling of being judged.
Mm-hmm.
And in social situations that they need to look a certain way.
Okay.
For men, it seems to be a little easier for them, you know, mm-hmm. and therefore they allow it to go that little bit further.
Right. And it's in terms of longevity, it also mentioned on that blog that things are improving, thank God. Yeah. So in the 1960s, the average Irish man could expect to live about 68 years, whereas now he should be around to celebrate his 75th birthday. Mm-hmm. So that's an extra 7 years, which yeah. is good to for listeners out there, you know, always say do something about it now. With regard back to gentlemen and their and image and the whole body image thing, also in the blog, it was interesting because it said 43% of men are more likely to be overweight compared with 31% of women. And although beer bellies are often the butt of many jokes, it's no laughing matter as this puts men at a greater risk of a heart attack. So I know we did, myself and Maeve, another member of our team, discussed about visceral fat and beer bellies. Are you finding, and in your experience, have you found a lot of men, is that mainly where they have are carrying the weight?
Yeah. A lot of men tend to, with women when they come in, it's kind of all over.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas men tend to carry it in the front of them.
Okay.
And again, it's only when it gets to that stage where they can't hide it anymore mm-hmm. that they'll come in.
Okay.
You know, and it's that hiding that uh-huh. again, going back to the blog.
Yeah.
You know, it's saying stop hiding those.
Exactly.
Yeah. You know.
Yeah.
Do something about it.
And probably easier for females now that you say to hide with the clothes, absolutely, than for the men and the beer belly. What's also was interesting in the blog, 12% of women are more likely to visit a GP than men. Mm. And I know this from experience, and any man I know and friends will say the same. I'm sick telling them, go to the doctor. Why do you think that is? Why are men bad at asking help, as we said at the beginning of the podcast?
Have you ever been in the car with a man?
Yes, many's a time. You tell
many
me.
How many times have you got lost with a man in the car?
Uh-huh.
And how often will they ask for directions?
Absolutely.
You know, and even I was thinking about this morning, even when they do ask for directions, they ask things like, do you know where it is? Mm-hmm. They don't actually say, I'm lost
exactly.
and I need help.
Exactly. You that know? Would be admitting I'm not perfect. I'm not the perfect man. Yeah.
And I was talking to my wife last night as an example. And she says there's many times that we've been completely lost before I'll actually ask for help.
Yeah.
And it's that thing of, I can do it on my own.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing of men liking to be self-sufficient and exhausting every avenue before actually getting any help. And you're right, go to a doctor.
Yeah.
Sure, I can do it myself.
And that's what happens. You said it there, exhausting every avenue. And unfortunately, I know you're seeing this as well in our clinics. We're seeing men leaving it to the last minute. And they're coming in, as you said at the beginning, they're coming in with not just a half a stone or a stone to lose. We're talking about a lot of weight coming in, male clients coming in at 20 stone, thereabouts, lower weights also, but they are inclined to leave it, you know, to go on and on and on. They're piling on more weight. So, you know, as we even said in the blog, if men would simply come and ask for the right help, it's okay to ask for the right help. It's okay to say, I'm not okay. That's a statement I heard a long time ago and I loved it. So joining motivation for you men out there teaches you to work simple habits into your daily life so that weight loss becomes relatively simple. And the most important thing is that it's not just a diet, as we're always saying, this is about keeping the weight off. So we're going to look at not just diet, but why you may be overeating, look at your unhealthy habits, behaviors and attitudes. So I think myself and Robbie are going to talk about